Hello, good morning to everybody. Talking about anticipatory action and the possibilities of responding to a disaster just before it strikes, I remember an anecdote for about, I think, 10 years ago. I received a call from Bolivia, from a humanitarian organization, a partner of us, who told me that the early warning system that, by the way, we were funding at that moment, had detected that a landslide, a big landslide, was going to happen in the following weeks. And they were requesting funding for responding to this imminent disaster. I was a bit embarrassed at that moment because, in fact, we could provide certainly humanitarian funding for disaster that had happened before, with eligibility dates from the date and the hour of the disaster, but it had never happened. We managed to finally, we tried it, we managed to get this funding, and the partner evacuated 1,000 families. They built quickly shelters, modular shelters in different neighborhoods of the city, and people were evacuated. By the way, one day after the evacuation of people from the neighborhood, the landslide happened and destroyed 1,000 houses, more than 1,000 houses. So basically, it was a success to be able to respond before the disaster. This was the way of saving lives, livelihoods, and avoid a major impact of the landslide. But we took three conclusions from that. The first of all was that, in fact, the funding mechanisms that we had were not adapted to this kind of situation. We needed to have more flexibility. In fact, we managed to have this funding, but the system was not planned to have funding or humanitarian funding before the disaster struck. I think it was a lesson, and because predictable funding is a key element for anticipatory action. This is clear. The second one is the importance of preparedness. If in this case no early warning system was in place or no interinstitutional coordination had been in place, it would have been impossible also to be able to react. And the last one is that not all disasters allow to apply anticipatory action, because in this particular case, we had the possibility to have an early warning system to detect the event previously. But this is not the case for all kind of disasters, for example, for an earthquake, as to give you an example. 10 years after, if we analyze the evolution towards flexibility, at least in the case of DigiEco, our organization is contributing to flexible funds that are ready to be disbursed ahead of the crisis. And some examples are the IFRC forecast-based action by the Disaster Relief Emergency Fund, the DREF, for example. Other one is the pilot support to be provided now to the country-based pool funds, the CDPF by UNOCHA. Another can be the crisis modifiers that we integrate in all the projects that we are funding, which allow to adapt the action to the disaster that is unforeseen is happening in the middle of the implementation period. And this allows us to react and to respond to an unforeseen event. In terms of preparedness, early warning system, risk data collection and analysis are key for successful anticipatory actions. In this sense, technology developments help to develop timelier and more effective response. We have examples in Central America where CEPREDENAC provides effective tools for the use of geospatial information in disaster response. But, however, sustainability, maintenance costs, data protection, and system interoperability must be thoroughly considered, and the opportunity for low technical solutions also duly evaluated. Otherwise, recent emergencies have shown the positive impact of cross-institutional coordination, notably with CIDEMA advanced regional coordination in information management when addressing the eruption of La Soufrière volcano in San Vicente that was happening a few months ago. As mentioned before, anticipatory action is not feasible in many cases. And some recent disasters, as for example the earthquake that happened a few months ago in Haiti, show the importance of keeping reinforcing the basics. It is the case of the school safety, the comprehensive school safety framework, or the comprehensive safe hospital framework. In particular, the need of updated mass casualty management plans. And this is, I think, is key for a response. Otherwise, COVID-19 has left us also some lessons. One of these lessons is the importance of having social protection systems that are really and truly sub-responsive, with databases of beneficiaries that are adapted to horizontal and vertical expansion in order to provide assistance to the most vulnerable in a disaster. And I think that this is extremely important. One example happened in Peru, where the integration of the Ministry of Social Inclusion in emergency coordination and the adaptation of their targeting model to be sub-responsive is a good example. Having said that, it is worth mentioning that anticipatory action is a priority identified by the DG ECO for the period between 2021 and 2024, as it is mentioned in the recently published Disaster Preparedness Guidance Note, in which ECO identified four priorities at global level. First one is the risk-based and anticipatory action. The second one, preparedness in conflict and fragile settings. The third one, the climate and environmental resilience. And the last one is the urban preparedness. DG ECO is promoting and supporting actions to contribute to the development of some essential steps, such as the comprehensive analysis of risks and forecasts, the support to early warning system, and the design of pre-agreed early action protocols, defining the triggers for action and responsibilities in this frame. In any case, to increase the effectiveness of this anticipatory approach, evidence gathering remains a critical, as well as to monitor the effectiveness of anticipatory action to inform the future action. In conclusion, for the effective implementation of anticipatory actions, we need first to foster accountability and capacity at local level, including broad partnerships to minimize duplication and to allow a systemic preparedness and response. Thank you.